Hey guys, so I don't know if it's necessarily a good idea to use the term rapture in the title, just because, most people hear that word and they automatically think I'm some kind of Bible thumper person. I know most of you know I'm not, but for any new people who happen to come across this video, I guess I should define rapture. Well, first, let me say, I think some of us are in the process of rapture right now. It's almost, I don't know, it almost feels like living in two worlds at the same time. And like you go back and forth between them. It's like we get so high, it literally feels like heaven on earth. Like, I swear, it's like I'm on New Earth, but it's not like my physical, but it's not like my body has physically moved somewhere. Or maybe it has, I don't know. But it's like I'm in an altered state of consciousness where I just feel totally connected to God and everyone else who's experiencing that same Christ consciousness. But then, like, all it takes is a distraction or too much thinking, and then it's like I'm back on the original earth or in that quote unquote normal state of consciousness. For me, rapture is the same thing as ascension. It's just one word is used for biblical people, and the other word is labeled as New Age. So it's like the language itself is set up to automatically make people pass judgment on a process that, I mean, the whole process itself, it's like the process is beyond all human words. But unfortunately, we have to use spoken language to get a point across. So if you don't like the word rapture, if it sounds too dogmatic, then just replace it with the word ascension. And if you don't like that word, then just replace it with spiritual singularity or whatever word makes you feel more comfortable. Anyways, the point is, we have to figure out a way to talk about this life-changing thing that we're in the middle of. And I'm having to invent new words and phrases over here because this whole thing is just so far beyond anything I could have ever even imagined. This altered state of consciousness, I've just started calling it Christ consciousness because that's what it feels like. It's the answer to every worry you've ever had, any negative feeling you've ever had. It's the answer to everything. Every desire you've ever had was actually for this. It's what you've been yearning for your whole life, even when you weren't consciously aware of it. That constant need to find happiness through objects was actually your yearning to merge with this Christ consciousness. And once you've had a taste of it and you're able to remember it, because it's like a dream that you fall in and out of, and sometimes it's hard to even retain your memory of such an infinitely blissful state like that. But once you've had a taste of it, like, you won't even have an interest in anything else after that, unless it involves God or God's people. It's pretty life-changing, and it takes years to adjust to it. You go through the dark night of the soul because the contrast between the Christ consciousness and what you were told your whole life was like regular life is just so different. It takes years to process. It takes years to acclimate. And there's no top to it. Like, it keeps growing and expanding, and it's like this indescribable love bliss that's beyond words. The people who are going through this right now, this walking in between two worlds, y'all know exactly what I'm talking about. It's our destiny. It's why we're here. So, I don't have time to go into detail about the spiritual singularity or the future events that have already happened that are pulling us towards it like a magnet. but I'll put a link to my consciousness art playlist if you're interested in that. But yeah, this video is going to be more so for the people who are already familiar with the Christ consciousness retrocausality. And actually, this video is more so a response to Be the Changes comment. Don't know if he wants me to use his real name or not, so I'll just call him D or Be the Change because that's the name of his channel. So me and him have just been kind of chatting back and forth about a song lyric video he posted, and he wrote a comment that I just want to read real quick. He said, quote, see if I can find it. Quote, "Yes, songs have been reaching out to me a lot too lately. It's like they show up to get my attention and steer my awareness back into a deeper perspective of what I'm supposed to be learning about life in this reality. Nice to hear from you, Vanessa." And then I said, quote, "Same here. I'm even starting to hear certain songs in my dreams. Nice chatting with you too, by the way." And so then his response to me was, quote, "Me too. I wake up with a phrase from lyrics of a song repeating in my head. Really random stuff too. Songs I haven't thought about or heard in years. I also have been getting a lot of ringing in my ears last couple months. I got that a lot several years ago. It subsided though, but has now returned in pretty much every day and mostly after waking up in the morning. It's mostly in the right ear, but sometimes in the left and always only lasts several seconds," unquote. So I was just gonna type my response back, but then I realized I have too much to say about the whole ear ringing thing. First off, I get the ear ringing too, a lot, like every day. It sounds like a really high-pitched frequency or tone that lasts a few seconds in one ear, but it's not coming from anywhere external. I've had it off and on my whole life, but it seems to be happening more lately. And I know there's some speculation out there about whether it's nefarious or caused by technology, but I don't know. I don't think it is, 'cause I mean, for one thing, I can remember being like as young as 4 or 5 and hearing it. So I don't think it's technology. I don't think it's a 5G thing just 'cause there wasn't any internet when I was little. And I don't think it's nefarious 'cause there's been times in the past where I felt like I was gonna have a panic attack, and then the ear ringing started, and it actually got rid of my anxiety instantly. So that's just my personal opinion on it, but I'm convinced it has something to do with a higher frequency or dimension coming through. And I'm starting to think it has something to do with being visited too. I say that because I've been getting visitations at night, and recently I came to the realization that this has probably been happening for years off and on. For the longest time, it scared the crap out of me because it was causing sleep paralysis, and for years I couldn't overcome the fear because, like, I kept trying to fight it and resist it. But not too long ago, I reached the point to where I learned to surrender to the terror of sleep paralysis. And once I was able to just wait for it to pass and stop trying to resist it, that's when things started to progress, like in a good way. Literally, just the other night, I realized once and for all what the sleep paralysis had always been about. And it's a shame it took me so long because the fear wouldn't let me see anything beyond it being a bad thing. But I think the only reason I thought it was scary was due to the way I was misinterpreting what was happening. And when you're in that state to where you're not fully awake, your mind can actually create images like that are really scary and seem really real. But like it was always just me. The fear was always coming from me, not something outside of myself. So I'm just gonna read some of what I wrote in my dream journal about this recent dream experience I had. Then I want to show you guys some of the retrocausality language transmissions I got about the ear ringing. Now, this is a separate recording I did that same morning, so if the audio seems a little bit off, that's why. So, I was dreaming that I was laying in my bed sleeping. Then I felt the familiar presence of the being that usually comes and stands by my bed. This is the same being that I used to fear standing by my bed in my dreams because I used to associate it with sleep paralysis. Over time, I learned that the fear associated with sleep paralysis was a product of my own human conditioning and that the fear had nothing to do with the being. So I felt no fear associated with the presence of this being standing by my bed in this dream I was having of me laying in bed sleeping. So I was dreaming, but in my dream I was laying in bed. Now it's weird because in the dream my eyes were closed, but it's almost like I was watching myself in bed, but at the same time I was in bed as well. So my eyes were closed, but I could also like see myself in bed dreaming in that dream. I don't know. It's weird. I was going to say something. I can't remember now. Let me think. I can't remember anymore. It was worth noting that even though I could only sense the one being, I also knew that there was about 2 to 4 additional beings there as well. It's like their consciousness were all connected somehow. However, I was only able to see the one being because they knew seeing more than one would feel too overwhelming for me. In terms of what the one being looked like, it appeared as the figure of a tall alien, but no details of its features could be seen. It was like a solid shadow in the outline of a bald, tall alien or ET. It wasn't an actual shadow though, like it was a solid being. It's just that in terms of like the details of the body, it was just in the whole thing was like the color of a shadow, but it was solid. It wasn't like I was looking at the shadow of something else. I would only get visual glimpses of it that would come and go. As soon as I sensed its presence, I already knew why it was there. It was there to do what it's done many times before. Like always, a loud ringing in my ear started that got louder and louder. It seemed louder than usual, like a loud train in my head. As the sound grew louder, the familiar feeling of falling backwards in semi-slow motion started like it always does. When the sound starts, and a deep, deep sleep fell over me, which sounds like that doesn't make sense because all of this is already happening inside of a dream, but that's the only way I can describe it. It is a feeling of falling under a sleep that's so deep it almost feels like you're being drugged. I've learned over time not to be afraid of this whole process because that's what this being does to put me in a state where I'm able to enter a dream within that dream, where it's easier for me to learn to lucid dream. So, always when I'm having the dream where it stands by my bed, I never realize I'm dreaming until I actually wake up. So I'm not lucid dreaming yet. This is the first initial dream I'm having where I don't realize that I'm dreaming. Now from that dream, they put me into a dream where I'm able to practice having a whole other separate dream where I can become lucid. So it's a dream within a dream, but I don't realize I'm dreaming until the whole process with the buzzing and falling sensation starts to happen. So anyways, back to when the whole process with the ear ringing starts. I'm consciously aware of what this being is doing. and I know there's no reason for me to be afraid. However, the human conditioning that the body holds on to makes it almost impossible not to feel some fear off and on. And just to pause there in my journal, this is an intense fear that is linked directly with the body. Like, it's almost like it's not me that's feeling this fear, it's like just the body's survival reaction, if that makes sense. And I think a lot of that happens with sleep paralysis too. It's like this with sleep paralysis, I know before I was able to like surrender to that fear, initially it was like this intense fear. And so it's like when you're in that state of intense fear and you're in the middle of a dream, that can also color what it is you're seeing in your dream as the sleep paralysis is happening. So I would just keep that in mind. All right, let me go back to where I was at. Makes it almost impossible not to feel some fear off and on. So it's like I was viewing my body in the dream jump and freak out from a higher state with zero fear, while at the same time still being aware of the short jolts of fear the body was experiencing due to its human conditioning. While the beginning of this process is happening with them putting me into that deep sleep state, and I'm hearing that train noise, at one point I calmly say to them telepathically, "I would rather not see you, because can you stand more behind my head instead of to my side, so I don't have to see you, because seeing you, even though it's just like a gray outline of you, is only going to freak out my human form even more." As I was communicating this to them, or it, both pronouns apply, I was watching my body experience fear, but I was in a place of total calmness. A big part of me even felt comforted that it/they were there, but like I said, the body was reacting in fear and trying to fight not falling into a deeper sleep state. The being's telepathic response back to me was, "You know, at some point you're gonna have to see us, right?" That was said in a very caring way, and they didn't use those specific words to convey that because they don't use separate words like humans do, but that was the gist of what they communicated telepathically back to me. So the train sound gets louder and louder, and I fall into a deep sleep dream. Once I enter into this second dream, within the first dream of them standing by my bed, initially it seems like another dream, like any other dream, but as I start to look around, I become lucid in that dream that I was put into. Even though the beings put me into that new dream, I still have full control over my level of lucidity. The dreams that they put me in are more like learning environments that I have control over, instead of a dream where they're, you know, in control of everything. The first place I found myself in was a house where people were in different rooms watching a football game. The level of interest and enthusiasm these people had in that football game made me think maybe it was the Super Bowl, because everyone seemed obsessed with the game. A part of me felt lonely because I wanted to be a part of the football game party too, but then I realized it was actually meaningless and their interest in the football game was a waste of time. That was the beginning of me starting to become lucid in that second dream. I kept walking around this huge house as I was looking around the different areas of this house. I started to become more and more lucid, or more and more aware of the fact that I was inside of a dream. At one point, I touched this gunk in the bathroom sink, and I just played with it with my fingers, amazed at how real it looked and felt. Then I found myself walking around a mall, and I walked around this mall in amazement of how visually it looked indistinguishable from waking life reality. If I didn't know I was dreaming, then I would have thought it was real. The only indicator that something was off about the reality was the behaviors of some of the animals inside the mall. Behaviors of some of the animals inside the mall were unusual. For example, I saw a small greyhound dog go inside a bathroom stall to use the bathroom like a human. Also, there was unusual behavior going on with this hawk. After I saw the dog go into the bathroom stall, I started to hear music coming from another part of the mall. I heard the beginning of Michael Jackson's Man in the Mirror song starting to play, so I started walking in that direction of the mall. As I was walking to try to find where the music was coming from, I see a guy with a glove on and a hawk perched on his gloved hand, kind of like something you'd see at the zoo. Even though I was lucid, I still was afraid that this hawk was going to attack me. As soon as I thought this, the hawk started to fly towards me and I started running, even though no one else in the mall seemed fazed by what was happening. The fear of being chased by the hawk caused me to lose lucidity and wake up from the dream. So, the picture that I'm showing is a picture of what I was seeing in terms of what the being slash beings looked like. But yeah, I just wanted to put this dream entry out there. Now, last year I had a dream where the same beings came in my room, but they looked more like the ones in the thumbnail to this video, but like skinnier and taller. And looking back now, I think there was another time when they or it appeared as a ball of like white light or energy. It kind of looked electric or something. But yeah, like I was saying earlier, I think my level of acceptance of what was happening during a visit can affect how they appear to me. Maybe. I don't know. I just know when I surrender to the fear, over time, it can literally change the appearance of certain things when I'm dreaming or having sleep paralysis. I remember one time my fear overtook me and the being appeared as Spider-Man for a couple seconds, then it changed back to into like the shadow figure. I think maybe that was to teach me that I have more control than I think over how things in my dreams look. But I don't know. When I'm in bed, that loud train sound always starts out as a ringing in my ears. And it's the same kind of ringing I get during the day that lasts for a few seconds, then goes away. But instead of it lasting for a couple seconds and stopping, it turns into like this loud, roaring white noise during the visitations. Like, it's so loud, it sounds like there's a train in my head. Echo Tear actually does a way better job of describing it. And I'll put a link in the description to his channel along with Be the Change too. But this is how he describes the sound.
But during this process, I'd spare my neighbors and I'd work with headphones and so I just had big headphones on and everything was looped on this record. And I had this thing, this idea that half the record should go forwards and the rest of it should go backwards. I don't know why. So it was very hypnotic. There was a lot of kind of unusual things that I did in that record to try and emulate these sounds that I would experience at night, which were like these kind of out-of-body sounds. Or if you're having like a genuine out-of-body experience, if you've experienced that, you'll know that like a prelude to actually having an experience like that is this sound that you get swirling around in your ears. And it's like, it sounds like the almost like the bagpipes or like the Tibetan chanting or the kind of horns they use. And I always attributed this to the idea of Gabriel's horn. When Gabriel blows his horn, because like really that's what it sounds like. It sounds like a horn. It's kind of got that guttural feeling. this kind of sound. And it's really intense, really, really super, super intense. And it gets louder and louder and louder until it almost feels like it kind of pushes you out. And that's a process that would go through like more or less every night. Once this record got up to steam, every night. And I think the reason why I was so had so many experiences like that, was so prolific, was because of the like the music was like a mantra, and it was like literally listening to mantras for, you know, hours on end, and or just loops, you know, certain kind of loops. And once I got to that point where my body was tired, my mind was still very, very active, super heightened, and then dawn would be coming, so I'd hit the sack quickly, and then my body could just shut down and go to sleep. So, you know, the body sleeps, the mind stays awake, and I'd have an out-of-body experience.
So that's the connection between the sound that we hear and going into a different plane. Now, for me, I hear that ear ringing that gets louder and louder when I get a visitation and get put into a lucid dream. But Echo Tear says he gets it when he's having an OBE. But I would just say, I don't think the ear ringing is a bad thing. I think there's a reason why you're getting more ear ringing again, Dee. I think there's definitely some kind of connection between the ear ringing and the spiritual singularity. And I've been getting some messages from the retrocausality language specifically about the ear ringing too. So I want to show you guys that along with some of the other transmissions. And then, as always, I'll put some exercises up at the end of this video to give you guys a chance to tune into the retrocausality language for yourself. So, when I was listening to the first exercise, the word red, R-E-D, got changed to red, R-E-A-D, which stood out as instructions telling us to read or understand the codes that are being sent back to us from the future through the retrocausality language. And the word rose, like the flower rose, changed to rose as in rising above something. So it changed rose into instructions telling us to rise above the lower collective consciousness to merge with the higher state of consciousness. And I think that's what the whole rapture thing is about. I think that's like the whole idea behind rapture. And you know, it's kind of funny because the word rose is actually the past tense form of rise. So the transmission is implying that something already happened. So it's almost like there's a code within a code that's cluing us into the whole retrocausal nature of time. Really, it's showing us that time is an illusion. And it's the same thing with the word red. Red is the past tense form of read. Now, your average person may hear this and just think, well, these aren't codes, this is just bad grammar. But, you know, keep in mind the retrocausality language doesn't always use proper grammar all the time. It can, but it can't 100% of the time because it's trying to describe the indescribable. Christ consciousness is indescribable. And source is infinite. Like, we're talking about something that's too big to be contained by our limited grammar rules. Really, it's impossible for it to be fully contained by any human language. Plus, it's coming from a higher dimension that's already transcended time. I mean, to this day, it still amazes me how it's able to use our language at all. Just because it's basically, like, with our language, it's almost impossible to even speak without it sounding like linear time is real, because so many words are given either a past tense or a pretense. So I think we just have to learn to step outside of the box when it comes to all the language rules we're used to using. But anyways, The word up in the lyrics changed into instructions telling us to rise above the lower collective consciousness in order to merge with the higher state of consciousness. And the same kind of transmission came through with the word where. Where stood out as a place where we merge with Christ consciousness. Basically, it's like the ultimate where. It's the only place we really feel like we fully belong. And it's in God's arms. But we don't have to search for some place outside of ourselves to find that. It's literally the higher state of consciousness that we merge with in the future. And I don't even think it's like a physical place. If you have to call it a place, I would call it New Earth. But even New Earth is composed of nothing but the higher collective consciousness. I mean, that's what this lower collective consciousness Earth is. That's what we call the external world. The external world is actually the collective consciousness. There is no world out there. But yeah, that's why our this whole invention that we came up with time and space, it's made everyone confused. It's made everything confusing. It creates the illusion that there's space and distance and like different physical locations, but really the only thing that changes is what's being witnessed by the consciousness. That's why you've never been somewhere over there. On a relative level, it seems like you have, but you've only ever been here. No matter where you quote unquote go, you always end up here, not there. Because you're not actually traveling through physical space to another physical location. It's all happening in consciousness. It's almost like saying, are you really walking around and going to different locations in your dream? No, you're not going anywhere. Your settings around you change, but you're not physically walking to different places. Now, the retro-causality language doesn't mind making a concession to meet us where we're at. Like it knows space and time aren't real because it's already transcended it. But in order to communicate with us in a way that we can understand, it uses the word where to represent a place we go to merge with Christ consciousness, even though technically we don't go anywhere because it's all consciousness. There's nothing but source. Like, you couldn't actually go anywhere to escape from source, even if you wanted to. The most someone could do is make themselves blind to source to create the delusion that God isn't everywhere. But that delusion wouldn't erase the fact that we still reside inside of God's consciousness. It would just make you delusional. But the words door and out both stood out as references about leaving a lower state of consciousness to merge with a higher state of consciousness, where Christ consciousness is possible. The word on changed into instructions telling us to turn our higher mind on, to tune into source and the higher codes. I heard Jeff talk about how it's you could also look at on as turning your thinking mind off and turning your heart on, but either way it takes us to the same place. And the retrocausality language changed the word day into an archetype for a time of spiritual awakening. And then, of course, the word sleep stood out as the opposite of day. So sleep was a reference about being asleep to God's presence, or like being spiritually blind. And the word dream changed into a reference about the dreamlike nature of God's creation. So earlier, when I was saying we reside in God's consciousness, basically that was just another way of saying we reside in God's mind or dream, which has nothing to do with sleep on that level. Source creating and source dreaming are the same thing. It's just, I think the word dreaming is more accurate than the word creating, because we've been conditioned to associate the whole creation story with some kind of physical world outside of his consciousness that was created. But I don't think this place is as physical as we've been taught. What if God is continuously dreaming us into existence instead of this place being some kind of physical external world outside of him that he created and then like walked away from or something. Personally, I prefer the word dream or dreaming over the word creating because there's nothing physical about a dream. Like literally everything in a dream is made up of consciousness. And since God is the ultimate consciousness, a lot of times you'll hear me say that God is the ultimate dreamer or like the one dreamer. But I'm not going to go too deep into that just because this video is already getting to be too long as it is. If anyone wants more info on that, I'll put a link to a video I did in the description called God's Mind, Synchronicity, McKenna's Time Wave Zero Theory. It's all just one video, it's just a long title. But yeah, these three exercises I'm gonna play mention the words hand, finger, and blood, which changed into metaphors for the parts of God's body, which is, I mean, it's us. Kind of like how sometimes you'll hear the saying, we're God's feet. That's the whole idea behind those metaphors, except they're actually true. Like we're literally holographic consciousness fractals of source. And you'll see when you do these exercises, the lines between pronouns like I and you will start to blur. Sometimes the retro-causality language will use the word hand to talk about God's hand, and sometimes it'll be a reference about us being like the fingers of God. But the word diamond changed into an archetype that represents us. Because think about it, diamonds are forever, and our souls are eternal. Plus, diamonds shine, like there's so many parallels, and it's that intense pressure that turns charcoal into shiny diamonds. And I think it's safe to say, that's what's happening to us in this life. All the pressure and stress we're going through isn't just for nothing, it's to turn us into even brighter diamonds. The word ring got decoded as a reference about the ear ringing we've been getting. And I know it sounds unbelievable, but I think it's the actual sound of a higher frequency coming into our awareness. If it were some kind of technology manipulation, then everyone within that same vicinity would be hearing this ringing, but that's not the case. Like you could be in a room full of people and only you would get the ear ringing. So it's not a technology thing. I think it actually has something to do with the literal sound of the veil being pierced a little bit. And I think the veil tearing happens on an individual basis for different people at different times. So it makes sense that some people would hear it at different times. It's like this higher frequency dimension that's behind the veil is piercing into our lower dimension, and we can hear it. Like we can hear it because it's operating at a higher tone or frequency. Like this is what different songs are talking about when they talk about wedding bells and wedding rings. It's talking about the ringing in the ears that signifies a divine marriage, and we're the bride that's lifting up our veil to be kissed. Now, while the retrocausality language was transmitting that message, simultaneously another code got overlaid on top of that one about how the word ring in the lyrics was also talking about a universal phone archetype. And you'll hear it too. There's countless songs with the same phone reference. Basically, it was talking about how the word ring or ringing is a reference to a ringing phone. And the phone itself was like a metaphor for a call or a means of communication between the higher spiritual realm and this realm. I'm telling you, these codes come in so quick, it's like you really have to slow down and stop with all the mind chatter in order to pick them up. But, the word home stood out as a reference to the place within our consciousness where we connect to God and feel at home. and the word in turned into instructions telling us to go within our heart to connect with our God center instead of focusing on the so-called external material world. The line that says, quote, today would be a first for me, the day I fall in love, unquote. The retrocausality language transmitted that that was talking about God's love falling down on us from a higher realm that brings us into the day. And like I said earlier, the day is when we stop being asleep. We stop being asleep to Source's presence, and we wake up to Christ consciousness. Now, even though that line mentions it being the first time, the word first wasn't about how this is the first time we've done this. We've left home and returned home many times in what we call other lives. In the last exercise, the word first was more so about how God's creation is like his first love. So it was like saying, we're his first love. We're his first. Okay. We're not second to him. We're first to him. And I'm almost done decoding, guys. I won't decode everything because I know this is going to be a long video, but the words crying and tears was a reference to tears of joy. The line that says, quote, we'll make love, let the telephone ring, unquote, that got decoded to mean we'll make source love, aka Christ consciousness, a reality for ourselves and let the ear ringing and higher communication continue. And you know, this goes without saying, that line has nothing to do with human romantic relationships or sex. Well, you know, I take that back. If your consciousness is anchored to the lower collective consciousness hive mind, then yeah, you're only going to see it as a reference about two humans having sex, which is fine if that's your level of awareness that you're operating on. But that's not how I see it. That's all I'm saying. The word sand stood out as a beach metaphor, which changed into a reference about the God ocean. And again, if you're new, just click the Consciousness Arc playlist in the description below. It'll explain all about what the God ocean is. The word over changed into a reference about how Source is present over everyone and everything, and how God is above us, even though technically God is everywhere. Like Source literally transcends all space and time and even permeates the music. The word sun, S-U-N, got decoded as a metaphor for God's warmth and love, but it also took on a second meaning of son, S-O-N, as in son or daughter of God. And then the line that says, quote, the skies will open, unquote. So there's two meanings to that line that are actually both valid, but the meaning that's going to stand out for you the most is going to depend on where your consciousness is on the higher collective consciousness spectrum. If at the time you're listening to that line, your awareness is on the escape key meaning level, then it'll tend to have a more literal meaning, because we can really see that, like, the sky is opening up, like the sky, we see that the sky is open. It looks huge, it looks expanded, like it's opened up and everything in it has somehow gotten closer to us. So the stars seem more vivid and HD looking. The clouds look really HD. Like sometimes they look so close, it's like I could reach out and touch them. And I've heard multiple people say the same thing. And I know a lot of you guys are seeing the same thing with the sky opening up. That all falls into the escape key meaning level, meaning, because it's about how the changes in the world are signs of our spiritual awakening. Now, if your awareness is slightly above the escape key meaning level and you're more in the yellow, then you'll hear an even higher meaning encoded in that line, where the sky is actually an archetype for a higher state of consciousness. So the codes we pick up on will depend on where our consciousness is on the emotional frequency scale, if that makes sense. Like in terms of how much of a match our emotional frequency is with source frequency. And if we want to be more of a match, then we have to tune in to source love. It's like we have to match frequencies or bring our frequency as close as we possibly can up to that higher love frequency that's in tune with source. And there's even a line that mentions the word tune, which got decoded as directions telling us to tune into the retrocausality language by focusing on source love or God's joy in order to hear the higher codes in the music. And you know, the same rules apply to the lower collective consciousness. It's just they don't have ears to hear. Like they hear that same line about the skies opening up and doesn't even register with them. They don't hear any of the higher codes, because when you're in the lower collective consciousness, essentially you're deaf to the retrocausality language. And that's not, I'm not being judgmental, I'm just saying, like, that's just how it is. They're deaf. And even us, before we go through that awakening process, we're deaf too. So that's, yeah, I'm not being judgmental or anything. Okay, so I'm done decoding. I'm gonna go ahead and play these three exercises. Oh, and real quick, so right now we're doing a group pre-fast, which is just basically us cutting back on carbs and sugar to make it easier to do the actual fast. But if you haven't started the pre-fast yet, it's still not too late to do it. And then the actual group fast will be from January 30th to February 2nd. And I'll put the dates for the group fast in the description too. But okay, so in order to do these exercises, it's important that you guys get rid of all the distractions and use this time to really focus on source. And I did capitalize certain words just to draw attention to some of the codes I got. So if you're kind of drawing a blank, you can always just look at the screen. But this really isn't a complicated thing. Like, you don't have to sit there and try to figure out what every word means. That's just extra thinking. And that's the last thing we want to do, is like thinking too much while we're doing this. I would say sit back, relax, and just listen to the music. The codes will just come through naturally if we focus on God's love. So use these exercises as your time to slow down and connect. And keep in mind too, there's never a time when God isn't trying to communicate with you. That's what the retrocausality language is there for. It uses archetypes to reflect each person's unique spiritual journey back to that person. That's how two people can hear the same song and get different messages. But in order to hear the higher codes, we have to tune in to God's unconditional love. So use these next couple minutes to just take a break. Like, stop thinking about the past, stop thinking about the future, and just be present in the here and now with source. Focus on God's love as you're listening to the whole song. And really ask yourself, God, if you could send me a message or a sign through this song, what would you want to tell me about?
Diamond ring, wear it on your hand, it's gonna tell the world I'm your only man. Diamond ring, diamond ring, baby, you're my everything. Diamond ring, red, red rose, bought it only you. The red, red rose tells me that red, red rose, blood red rose, light the fire inside that grows, blood red rose. when you're crying, I'll be the tears for you. There's nothing that I wouldn't do for you. Then I looked into your eyes and knew today would be a first for me. That the bells will ring, the birds will sing, the sky.